It's been about a month now since I started using the M4 Mark Mini, the base model, and wow, what a journey it's been. From handling complex projects in Logic Pro, editing videos and gaming, yep, I did proper gaming as well, even running LLMs locally, this little wonder here has handled more than I thought it would ever be possible. I did push it to the limits, I found some limits, I'll share them in a minute, but for the price, it's got me rethinking my entire productivity setup here, not just for content creation, but for everything that I do. In fact, I'm wondering, did Apple make a mistake here? Did they give us too much? And because my base model videos were so popular, I went and tested, so many of you asked me to do it. So I went and bought the M4 Pro version, pushing both to the limits and testing them, comparing them as well. And today I'll break it all down for you, you know, what the experience has been in the last almost like a month, where they fall short, and which one might be the perfect one for you. I don't know how much computer you need, but I'll share with you those limits that I found in each of these, and hopefully that can help you with your decision. I'm Alex, and I do Down to Earth Tech videos. Let's start with the base model then, because this machine is, without exaggeration, the best computer from a value perspective that you can buy right now. At $599, I think it's even cheaper now if you're watching this during the Black Friday or Cyber Monday period, it's not just a Mac Mini, it's a workhorse, right? It's one of those things that, after my stress tests, the videos that I've done to kind of really pushing these machines, I've been recommending this to so many people, genuinely going, I mean, if you watch my videos, if you've been here for a while, you know that I'm not a big fan of Apple stuff, but I can't help but recommend this. You know, I have to give credit where credit is due, whether you're a student, content creator, anyone on a budget, it checks so many boxes, not just because of the budget perspective, but it's just very capable. The only thing I would suggest, and I've been saying that to everyone, is pair it with a good external SSD and a good hub as well, because especially if you're a photographer, there's no SD cards in here, so you're gonna need some access to that. Because seriously, if you can, avoid Apple's storage upgrades, right? Because in the majority of scenarios, they just don't make a lot of sense financially. The Mini is fantastic from a value perspective, but it can quickly become overpriced, you know, if you start giving money to Apple for storage upgrades. Talking about storage, Thunderbolt 5 is not readily available yet, which is frustrating, but Thunderbolt 4 is. And to be honest, it's more than enough for today's needs. As I've shown you here, everything that I did was either, you know, via a Thunderbolt 4 cable or, you know, on its local storage. And in my tests, it could easily handle even 4K ProRes 422 projects. In English, that's pretty much as heavy as it gets from a video processing perspective. And by the way, I didn't just try like 5 to 10 minute clips, right? It was like in one scenario, it was a 45 minute long video, lots of log footage, you know, really like not compressed at all, with plenty of transitions and effects. And it felt great, you know, working through the timeline, everything was very smooth. Sure, you know, gotta be honest, right? The export times are very slow, much slower than a beefier Mac, but editing itself, it's very smooth and frustration-free. And the export times were slow in a very extreme scenario. For most people, that export time, you know, would probably be 10, 15 minutes, you know, for most sort of short videos. And this has been the case as well with After Effects and LLM work as well. But right now, based on the tests that I've been running, a Thunderbolt 5 hub in this scenario makes no odds really, because the bottleneck is usually being on GPU and the media engine for most of the stuff that I've been testing, rather than access to fast storage. And what's been so nice about the Mac Mini as well is that I keep discovering different use cases for it, right? It's not just a productivity beast and, you know, content creation beast. Mac Mini can be a great portable solution. That's one of the things that I discovered almost by accident, having to take this home one day to do some tests. It was like, oh, I can literally just pack a keyboard and a mouse and I'm in. And it's also perfect as a home entertainment hub. It's quiet, low energy, and incredibly capable of running, you know, 4K content. No issues, right?
You get the thing.
Which is where our sponsors for today comes in. There's something quite magical, right, about turning your living room into a cinematic experience, you know, getting your family in and having a movie night, for example. I tried a few projectors this year, and let me tell you, you know, the 4 Movie Theater Premium is a bit like the Mac Mini. The Mac Mini made me rethink my computing needs, and the 4 Movie Theater Premium made me completely change my home entertainment setup. And this is more than just a bog standard projector. It's a 4K laser TV that blends cutting edge ALPD RGB Plus 4.0 technology with a super compact ultra short throw design. You can project a massive 150 inch screen from just a few centimeters away. That means you could get the full theater experience without turning your home into like a tech lab, right? The visuals are stunning. Even though they look good here, I don't think it does justice to what I can see from, you know, with the naked eye. With over 2200 ISO lumens and a 107% of the BT2020 color gamut, the picture is very bright, detailed, and incredibly like lifelike. And yes, it's also got Dolby Vision support, HDR 10 plus decoding support as well for those true to life highlights and shadows. I know this sounds a little bit like a spec sheet, but it's true. It does look incredible. The setup itself was ridiculously easy as well. Focusing is no problem, just a couple of clicks really to do, very easy. Keystone correction, that can be complicated in some projectors, not here. Absolutely, you know, I only needed some minor tweaks anyway, but it was a breeze to do. Plus, it comes with Google TV and native Netflix, so no more fussing with extra streaming devices, you know, everything, or more cables even, right? Everything you need is built in right there. Once I signed into my Google account, all my other services synced up, which was nice. And can we talk about sound? Wow. Bowers & Wilkins second gen acoustic Dolby Atmos here in DTS:X makes everything sound as good as it looks, really. From a budget point of view, I think there's something really cool here, right? Because you could start with this projector alone without the need to invest in audio gear straight away, because the audio quality is so good on this projector. It really allows you to, you know, run it by itself for a few months until you're ready to upgrade to a home theater setup, if you want to, you know, because in a lot of rooms, just the projector might be more than okay. Whether you're into movies, gaming with ultra low 80 milliseconds latency, or just want a killer home entertainment system, the full movie theater system is going to be a fantastic upgrade for you. If you want to check them out, just check the links in the description. They're always running, you know, promotions anyway. Or if you're watching this on my TV, scan the QR code here. And thanks so much for Movie for sponsoring this video.
And put this back, my back. So old.
Now let's talk about heavy workloads on this tiny little wonders here, right? To recap, I tested and retested Blender for 3D projects. As many of you asked, I mean, it was one of the most popular things that you asked me to do, and the results were truly eye-opening, right? I can't think of any other words, especially when I compared rendering performance on the M1 MacBook Pro, which is a maxed out 64 gig RAM machine. The Mac Mini wasn't just a little bit faster, but in one scene, which is a very complex scene in Blender, the render speed was 30 minutes faster on the base model Mac Mini. The Mac Mini had 40 active tabs in Chrome while it was exporting, and I was using that at the same time. I haven't recovered from that. The M1 Max only had Blender running, and it did half an hour later. So like, in some situations, it's obviously better to have more memory, more cores. Well, in a lot of situations, that's gonna be true, but in some situations, what I found is that it's better to have just a newer chipset. Apple hasn't been great on many things, especially from a handheld perspective, but when it comes to their chipset, you know, it's exponentially better. So when they say, you know, it's 10 times faster, 30 times faster, a lot of it is marketing mumbo jumbo, but when it comes to the Mac Mini, it's true. It's, you know, and for $600, that's mental. Equally incredible though is using the Mac Mini for Logic Pro. I had to learn some of this stuff, but the base model only started to struggle past 150 tracks, very complex tracks as well. In my first video, I didn't really know much of what I was doing, but one of you sent me actually a live project that I then kind of expanded into and added some third-party plugins. I think it wasn't really anything too complex, but it was enough to kind of show a real life in there. So 150 tracks was when I saw the Mac Mini, the base model, struggle a little bit, and the M4 Pro Mac Mini, also the base model one, went beyond 200 and it only really struggled with 300 tracks, which, I don't know. I mean, it started to get a little bit unrealistic, you know, to even try to do something like that. But if you've missed my earlier tests, definitely check them out after this, because I haven't seen many videos out there that cover so many different tests. And as you can probably tell, I'm quite proud of that one. I mean, it was hard work, but I think because you got involved in it, it made the videos more meaningful. So yeah, definitely watch that if you haven't seen it yet. Now for photographers out there, using Lightroom, in the last month I tried a few different scenarios. The base model handles something like 200 raw imports, you know, and trying to edit them at the same time. Anything more than that, you know, it's kind of struggles. I tried 1500 at one point, and that definitely broke the Mac Mini, the base model. So yeah, if your workflow involves thousands of raw files, the M4 Pro is probably going to be the better option for you with a bit more memory. In fact, you know, this was the first test that I saw the system overload error that said, like, you have to close some stuff because we can't handle this. The Mac Mini, within reason, will be a fantastic machine for many pros out there, but if you want to see it, you know, what really makes it crash out and die, those videos will give you an idea. And talking about crashing out, I fully expected this not to work on the, especially on the $600 version, but it did, which is running AI workloads using LLMs. Specifically, I was running Llama models. I tried different sizes, 3B and 7B and some crazy ones that failed straight away. But running LLMs on the base model was surprisingly smooth. I mean, fine tuning remains a challenge. Not necessarily for the Mac Mini itself, but for me. It's been a steep learning curve, having to learn Python, and you know, it's no joke, but I will persevere. And the results so far have shown some crazy things, right? You can definitely explore AI on a budget, is my bottom line here. But, and by the way, I'm so grateful to all of you who have been asking for me to do a dedicated LLM video, and it's coming. And I now know enough to be dangerous, let's put it that way. And have found some, like, you know, what makes the M1 Max, for example, completely die. So I know the limits are in there. And I nearly cracked it last week to do that on the M4 Mac Minis. But there are so many challenges in doing AI work on this, especially fine tuning. So when I fix one thing, it breaks another. So I have to keep tweaking and find out. I reckon I'm about a week away from the video being ready for you, so hang in there, I haven't forgotten. I just appreciate that you're asking for it. Now, gaming also blew me away. That was the first thing that made me think, hang on, how is this even possible? I was playing Cyberpunk 2077 on the base model, using crossover, of course. I tried using, like, parallels in Windows. You know, there's some limitations in that software because it doesn't have DirectX, or the right version of it anyway. But running things that the native games like Resident Evil natively is looking stunning. It's not yet like a gaming PC level, of course, but for casual gaming, it's more than enough. It's actually weird to even be talking about gaming at this level on a Mac, but they're getting there slowly, but they are getting there. After a couple of weeks, I switched my attention to the M4 Pro. Also the base model. I refuse to give Apple any extra money, right? It's $1,400 or pounds here in the UK, but the speed boost is undeniable, right? Tasks like exporting 4K video and rendering large 3D scenes are not just a little bit faster, they are significant, you know, you can see where your money is going. It's not just about speed though. What I found specifically with AI workloads, bear in mind I'm a total noob, I'm making lots of mistakes here, but I'm really enjoying this. But I'm finding that the quality of the response is better on the M4 Pro in some situations, which is a bit counterintuitive. You know, the more I learn about this, the more I'm thinking maybe I'm doing something wrong. But particularly in image generation, I found the Pro to give more accurate results. So not just faster, but it responded better to prompts, right? I just saw that quite clearly in Stable Diffusion. When I was doing those tests, you know, some prompts on the M4, on the base model Mac Mini just got completely ignored. Whereas on the Pro, it's the exact same prompt, exact same software, all the settings are the same. I got different results, more accurate results. Look, at the end of the day, the decision comes down to your workflow. You know, what you do with these is what's going to dictate what you buy. Who am I to tell you what to do, right? But if you're a student, a casual creator, or someone who just needs a solid desktop, the base model is unbeatable. But if you're constantly working with hundreds of raw images, you know, extreme large logic processions or advanced AI models, the M4 Pro, of course, is gonna, you know, with lots more memory as well, is gonna be better for you. But I might even consider the M2 Ultra Studio. I don't know, from a money perspective, I wonder if that's gonna be better, but that's another video. When it comes to the Mac Mini, I'm still team base model. So leave a hashtag, I don't know, base model gang or something down here in the comments so I know that you watched this far. By the way, creating these videos is something that, I don't know, reignited my passion for YouTube reviews in general.
Oh yeah,
hopefully. Not even kidding, hopefully. It's 1 a.m. here in the UK, but I'm really enjoying talking about this stuff and, you know, kind of discovering all the limits on these things, and mainly because they are answering questions that you have. And, you know, going out and learning Logic Pro, LLMs, machine learning made me consider different points of view for my videos in general going forward, and ultimately I think made me a better reviewer. So anyone can take a gadget out of the box and say how pretty it is, how small it is, how affordable it is. But answering my audience questions is something that, I don't know, felt much more rewarding, especially when I saw all the feedback in the comments as well. And over 3,000 of you signed up to that this month alone. And I'm beyond grateful. Honestly, you know, that's why I'm here at 1 a.m. on a Saturday night making this video, because I know it's meaningful to some people. Of course, I've had to make other videos that end up funding this stuff and funding the channel, but you taught me something this month and I'll definitely take that on board for the next year. With that said, if you haven't subscribed yet, this is a perfect opportunity for that. If you like my content, of course, right? Now, for me and the Mac Minis, what's next? I'm planning something quite cool. I think you're gonna like this. You know, I'm gonna turn the Mac Mini into a portable run and gun workstation with a travel case, an external monitor. Let me show you this.
Oh God.
This is the espresso display and all it needs is a USB-C cable to the Mac Mini. Very lightweight, easy to take anywhere. I think it's gonna be the ultimate on-the-go setup. Whether it's useful or just a bit of fun, I'll let you decide when that video comes out. And if you want to know how that turns out, obviously you know where to find me. Make sure you're subscribed. And honestly, thank you again for all your ideas and all your support for these videos. If you enjoyed this video, share it with your tech loving friends as well. Put it on that WhatsApp group. I'm sure someone in there will find it useful. And let's keep geeking out on these machines here. I think Apple did a blinder here. They're really good. See you soon.